Year 2017 retrospective. Yeah, this is a sort of a bit of a review and the important points that I think to point out, not so much what happened, but also what we can learn from this. So we have a new acronym that we just introduced recently. It's CNI, is the core network cellular network infrastructure. Sort of the problem is Osmocom is a larger project and the GSM stuff is only part of it, and we never really had a proper name for the GSM or the 2G, 3G stuff inside, and CNI is sort of a new name for all the GSM/3G projects and to separate that group of projects from like RTL-SDR or Osmo Tetra or Osmo GMR or something like that. Anyway, yeah, so we had software changes, we had team or developer changes, and we had also for Sysmocom some focus changes which affect the project. So on the software changes, we already know there's the Osmo BSC migration from SCCVLite to A over IP. We had Osmo MTW now as a new integral part. We have the NITB split. We had 3G support that went mainline, was developed in 2016, but only went to master in 2017. So lots of software changes. We also had some team.
Why does everyone miss Osmo STP?
It's insignificant.
Yeah,
but you know, I mean, there's also you know, the TCP stack and the SCTP stack and like or the kernel or the operating system that we run on. So the STP is something like that. It's just like infrastructure underneath that you don't really think of. It's, you know, it's it passes messages from left to right and routes them. So anyway, that's. We had some team, I'm going back to 2017, but still to put things in context. So Jakob, who has been doing a lot of work, particularly in Osmo PCU, had left Sysmocom at the time, so which means particularly also PCU has received a distinct lack of attention. Also Jolly, of course, changed his focus away from the GSM projects to Osmocom Analog and other projects. So we have some lack of attention on the PCU. Holger has left Sysmocom, which also not directly, but indirectly over time, as I think you all have witnessed, the primary focus has shifted away from Osmocom, which is a big loss in terms of skill and capacity for sure. Earlier this year, Maxim left Sysmocom. And yeah, it's again another loss of existing know-how and yeah, knowledge basically. Yeah, I mean, who knows? I don't want to make predictions. So yes, he may be back, but we don't know now. So a lot can happen in a year. So I don't want to expect it or to take it for granted. So we'll see. Well, maybe. Then we can use an Osmo GR Osmo SDR based ADSB receiver to track him. Anyway, so at Sysmocom we traditionally had a lot of non-Osmocom projects and work that we did to cross-subsidized Osmocom work. So since not a lot of revenue was coming from Osmocom-related projects, we did other stuff to finance the work on Osmocom, which distracted resources quite a bit in 2015. That's now gone. But also used to be the case that as we did cross-subsidize a lot of Osmo development by hardware sales. So if you bought some Sysmocom devices, then that basically paid for many days, if not weeks, of development time. That's not happening as much anymore as it used to be. But on the good side, it means that at the Sysmocom team, we now almost work 100% on Osmocom projects by R&D projects, support contracts, and grants. So the amount of interest in professional services, support, and development projects on the Osmocom stack has increased to a point where we don't necessarily need to cross-subsidize from such other sources, which is good, and I hope that continues for the time being, so we don't have to cross-subsidize. So looking at the NITB aftermath, it's the biggest architectural change since 2008. So it's really basically turned upside down many parts of the project. I mean, of course, there's stuff that didn't change, like the RSL code or the OML code talking to the VTS. But apart from that, a lot of things have changed. I mean, there were lots of good reasons. And we have all kinds of things now that we didn't have before, like proper finite state machines with timeouts, cleanup code, integrated logging into that, and so on. We have 3GPP compliant A over IP with interop testing to other implementations. We don't have the synchronous HLR database access anymore. We have shared HLR from MSC and SGSN. We have 2G, 3G authentication, and so on. So we have lots of advantages in various ways. But then, of course, there's also bad parts from the split NITB. We had a never-ending list of breakage, and that is sort of separated into two parts. One is actual regressions, so things that used to work on NITB but didn't work on the split architecture anymore, unexpectedly, so not like that we something was not ported or something, but real regressions. Then we had also, of course, known omissions during restructuring, like the measurement feed sort of was, and as Niels said, he just removed it or disabled it meanwhile. He's re-enabling it now after some time in the split code. And we also have some commercial users, and actually I think in terms of funding, rather significant commercial users that are stuck with SCCP Lite. For various reasons, and thus use the old, not sure why the formatting instructions show up here, the Osmo BSC SCCP Lite now, which has almost none of the new features and bug fixes and improvements, so they're not benefiting from this. Also means there's no automatic testing, whereas we have lots of automatic testing now on the split architecture that the old one doesn't have it. And we have some have to do some backports, which are time-consuming and distracting us from focusing on the new implementation. And the reason is basically quite simple, because there are some MSC vendors that simply don't implement 3GPP A over IP, even in newer releases. These are mostly smaller core network vendors, like Quartus, for example, that don't do 3GPP A over IP, but only SCCP Lite. And they have apparently no roadmap to ever change that. I mean, it's just what we hear indirectly from users. On the other hand, the more classic larger operators that have Ericsson or Huawei or whatsoever, they only have A over IP 3GPP compliance, so it's sort of a problem. So what did we learn? Well, the overall complexity is quite stunning now. Sorry?
That's a nice typo.
Sorry? Osomkum, yeah. That's, you know, it was so the complexity was so stunning, I couldn't even write properly anymore. The absence of proper functional testing has caused lots of fallout. Of course, if we did have a test suite for the old stuff, then we could have probably run the test suite before and after the split, and we would have seen some fallout from that. But actually, the split architecture allows us for better testing. Yeah, with again typos, you can see I wrote this probably half asleep. It allows us to test smaller parts. I mean, if you wanted to test only the BSC part before, you just simply couldn't, because there was no way to access only the MSC part in OpenBSC or in Osmo NITB. So that's good, and so testing has become my main focus in the last couple of months. Yeah, so testing, and some more testing, and even more testing beyond that. So what do we have in place now in terms of testing? What we always had is the unit testing in our C code, which tests individual functions or APIs, which is nice for like testing a message encoder or a message parser or something like that, where you don't have any state or any complexity. You just have data in, data out, and you check whether the result is what you want. These we execute during make check. We now have the automatized functional tests in TTCN3. where we test the external visible behavior, right? The API tests test internal API, and the TTC and 3 tests test the externally visible behavior on all the specified interfaces, whether it's ABIS-A, GSAP, GTP, MNCC, PCU interface, control interface, VTY interface. So these kind of external interfaces are tested there. We execute them right now nightly by Jenkins. We could, of course, do that more frequently. The tests currently take quite some time to run. Most of it is test setup and teardown and not the actual test suite. So there can be quite a bit of optimization in terms of execution. It just hasn't been the focus. So the focus right now has been on test coverage and not on optimizing the execution time of the tests. But we could improve that and probably execute them more frequently, maybe up to the point of executing them as part of Garrett verification. Beyond that, we have Osmo GSM Tester, which tests, again, the entire OsmooCom, another way of spelling OsmoCom in recent 10. Yeah, so some cows involved with all the different components. It uses real BTS and MS hardware over coaxial cable, and we execute it. How often do we execute it these days, Pao?
As soon
as possible. Yeah, so basically, it will... Yeah, it will execute the test suite, and when it's completed and there are new commits ever since, right, it executes again.
Yeah, new commits or it's figured out hourly.
Yeah, okay, so at least once per hour or more frequently if there are new commits and the hardware is not busy executing the previous test. So Pao will tell us more about what we do there tomorrow, I think, is the time slot for this talk. That tests the overall system and not the individual components, and it tests it on a very high level, so we don't look at protocol messages, but we just like basically use a modem to make a call, and it's almost like user testing, but with automatic users. Then we have some interoperability testing, where we do tests. One thing we have at SysmoCom in the lab is what's called an NG40, that's a proprietary RAN and core network simulator. From NG4T, I'm not sure where that percent sign is coming from, probably because percent is above the T letter on the keyboard. And there we can test on the AGB and IU level. And since it's both a RAN and a core network simulator, we can either use the OsmoCom RAN against their core network, or we can run the OsmoCom core network against their RAN. And it can simulate millions of subscribers and hundreds of BTSs and BSCs and node Bs and so on. We can do that. It's not fully automatized yet. We do some basic testing that's in Jenkins, but...
We are testing the Osmo MSC automatically.
Okay, so the comment was we're testing Osmo MSC automatically, or some... It's only very few tests, I think. Only location updates, so there's much more possibilities there to be done and to automatize. But I would restrict that mainly for interoperability, since we don't want to introduce dependencies on proprietary testing tools. But it's always good to test against somebody else's implementation, of course, and not test OsmoCom code against OsmoCom code. Yeah, so what's the project health of the cellular network infrastructure? Well, we have lots of funded development, but... primarily, of course, enterprise features that are required by professional users that actually have funds available to do funding. What I also see problematic is the dominance of SysmoCom in those projects. Sustainable FOSS projects don't have a single point of failure, and that includes SysmoCom as a company. And I would much rather see more active participation from other entities and or individuals or research entities, God knows what. The fact, I don't know what the actual statistics were. I think about a year ago we did some statistics on the commits, how many of the commits were from SysmoCom and from others, and it was quite troubling, yeah. So we need more contributions from third parties, particularly those that benefit commercially, of course, because they should have some incentive. Unfortunately, we do have some players that do that very well, some known or some unknown, some public, some non-public. I mean, you know that OnWaves, for example, is that's public fact. Rock has been telling us last year about how they use Osmocom in their maritime GSM network. We have others that choose to remain in the dark as to who they are, but we do have some commercial users that understand how that they need to support free software. But then we have some others where I'm more losing patience actually, and I'm more likely to call them out anytime soon, who basically we know are using it in commercial deployments a lot, but who don't bother to send patches and or improvements and or contribute to a significant extent. Project health beyond other projects is quite disturbing. So Osmocom Dedra is basically dead since 2012, apart from some occasional fixes. Osmocom BB has still not been ported to any other PHY. I mean, there are some attempts by one person mostly, but it's very far from getting to completion. Osmocom DECT, much to my dismay, is completely dead. It's basically, at one point, it was already possible to run a DECT-based station completely with Osmocom DECT without any proprietary components, so you could have a DECT phone and an Osmocom DECT and then interface to Asterisk without any proprietary base station. The Erlang core network projects are basically dead. I mean, for sure they can be resurrected, but basically there was never any contributions from anyone else. So with the C projects, at least we get some contributions. Well, which open source cellular network related Erlang projects?
Basically, Vance is actively working on C-Tran Erlang stack right now. It's GitHub. It is being actively developed as of right
now. Yeah, so basically, you're saying there is Vance Shipley is working on a C-Tran stack, but okay, that's not an Osmocom project that has moved somewhere else. This is about Osmocom project health. I'm saying the Osmocom Erlang core network projects are dead. But I'm not aware of anyone doing something with them outside of Osmocom or just move them somewhere else. Sure, other people are doing work. I mean, there's MobiSense that are doing core network related stuff in Java. It's open source. I mean, I'm not talking about these projects here. SimTrace is basically dead again and about to be resurrected as every year. but now there's a lot of pressure to do so. If I look at some other projects, and I don't want to, this is not complaining, this is just, I've just been looking at different Git repositories and statistics. And I see that there's very few commits in GR Osmo SDR. I see that RTL SDR had no commits in 3 years, I think. It's fine. I'm just stating facts. This is not a judgment. Yeah, that's fine. I'm just saying. You see my last point? It's not that bad. See, next slide. So we have some activity in the Osmocom BB world, which I'm very happy about. There is GRGSM, Fake TRX, and TRXCon work by Vadim. We also had the VertFi work earlier by, now this is embarrassing. Sebastian, yes. Yes, my apologies. Yes, Piotr, of course. We have Osmocom Analog, which is very active, but it's basically Jolly's child. I'm not sure if anyone else has contributed much. I mean, at least not from the classic Osmocom community. I'm not aware, but...
I gave him a phone.
Okay, you gave...
I gave him more.
It's a silent contribution anyway, but I really enjoy to see so much progress there. He's implemented not only RNets, BNets, and CNets, but also he's implemented AMPS, the American analog telephony, and he has also implemented the what's the Nordic one, NMT. Yes, so it's really getting complete. All of analog. Yeah. Ah, okay. Yeah, so the comment was the Globalstar satellite phones, the analog old ones use amps too, so there might be some collaboration there. So now, soon, we will have Osmo FL2K, which is great. So if we look again at the cellular network stuff, the RAN side is quite strong and complete these days. Sure, there are always things that you can improve, but the BTS and BSC, I think, are... It's also something where we focused our attention on, also in the terms of testing. So we will see that Osmo BTS and Osmo BSC have many more TTCN3 tests compared to Osmo MSC or Osmo HLR. And that's quite, how can I say, intentional, because there are lots of users who have an interest in using the RAN, even with third-party MSCs and so on. The packet switched RAN suffers from a lot of lack of attention. That's Osmo PCU. Where we don't have any automatic test suite with decent coverage at all, and we still have lack of uplink multi-slot and many EGPRS features. So it's still quite in desperate need of attention. I started to do some Osmo PCU tests in TTCN3 now, which I'll get to probably tomorrow, maybe. But it's still a very humble beginning, but we want to have tests that test, I think, for example, now we have a test for uplink TBF establishment. So you really test very low-level transactions or things that happen in the physical layer, and not a high-level testing or from a user point of view, but really individual procedures or individual events, and so on. And the MSC and HLR, I think, are in a healthy state now, or at all. But they still lack TCAP or MAP capabilities, which makes the limit or the usability of them restricted to non-roaming networks. Non-roaming means, I mean, yes, you can of course have roaming, but not roaming with existing operators, since there is no related interface. And the packet switch core network, yeah. Yeah, the microphone is in front of you.
Sorry. It's not only non-roaming, but also networks which are not interconnecting with any other proper carriers, because, for example, you can't exchange SMS, you know, without MAP with any other proper carrier.
Yeah.
I'll speak about that.
That's correct, but on the other hand, I think there are probably not so many use cases where you would just want that without roaming capabilities. So it's a bit, So the packet switch core network, I think, are in good health, more the GGSN even than the SGSN. SGSN now has IPv6 support, yeah, even with Supoppert. Kernel GTP acceleration, there seems to be some users say they cannot get it to work, but we will investigate that in the very next days. There's also quite a bit of inquiries from commercial users in this area, so I have high confidence that we will have some working and performing solution there. We have created a test bed now, but haven't run any performance tests yet. At Sysmocom, we have 3 machines interconnected with 100 gig Ethernet cards, and I want to benchmark the kernel GTP code as to what kind of throughput we can get with the existing in-kernel user plane and user space control plane. So, outlook. 2G is still in demand, and we have lots of use cases, whether it's rural network, maritime networks, and so on. If we had TCAP and MAP, many more deployments would be possible. But then, typically, the kind of inquiries we get, they never really want to fund related interfaces. So, well, I mean, you get what you pay for. So if you have no interest in investing in TCAP or MAP interface, well, then you also don't have one and you have to go somewhere else. I think that's fair. the 3G user has some users, but I think the lack of a FOSS RNC limits us to femtocells, and that makes it not very interesting outside of lab use. And I don't think this will change. So that's also why, in terms of, sorry? Well, not everywhere. Again, thinking of what kind of equipment you can deploy inexpensively that gets decommissioned elsewhere, there's quite a lot of capacity and capability, and we have at least two, actually more than two commercial customers. If we had a solution for 3G macro, they would immediately deploy it, but we don't have anything. So it's not such a theoretic option. Yeah, in absence of an RNC, and I don't think anyone has an interest of doing that, there is no and there's no soft RNC that I'm aware of that you can could license even proprietary as a part or something. Just nobody does that, so there's not really any future. Beyond lab usage, that also explains why we don't have any tests yet in TTC and 3 for the 3G interfaces. It's possible, but writing test cases, we do have sort of, it's easy to adapt to interface the protocols we have there, but writing test cases, it's just not going to be a priority anytime soon. 4G, of course, is deployed in parallel to 2G in many scenarios. What I think we need to look at is 2G, 4G integration. That's the SGS interface. That's GSUB to diameter translation. I think we need to do is contribute to existing fast 4G projects in that area. Maybe starting by those interfaces, so implementing SGS on our side and also implementing it on the other side maybe and have a good interoperability there. Yeah.
And what about extending HLR to support HSS as well, for example, because that's one of the...
I don't think it makes sense. The Osmo HLR that we have today is nothing more than a simplistic reference example of how you can implement it, but it's never been designed as a large-scale HLR or something like that. It's really just a small database, and I think it's rather more likely that we have a GSUB to diameter translator and then have an external HSS that would find attention to, but we'll see. At least that's my point of view. And the irony that sort of I find always disappointing is that it's very possible to do properly funded Osmocom development these days, but we have less people involved than in the early days. That's sort of a problem. Sorry? But it's still, I think actually in some ways it's more structured than before, so it's less... Well, I beg to differ, but okay. But I think it's sort of a pity. And the other point that I don't have here on this slide is that it's very easy for us to find project work related to 2G or even 3G, but it's almost impossible to find some funding for open source 4G, at least that's our experience. Not sure if somebody else has other experience, but there's almost no interest. And the inquiries that we get is extremely 2G oriented still today. Outlook, I think the original activity of the original developers has decreased, and we need to attract more developers. Otherwise, I don't really see much of a future, and we need to distribute the involvement and have Sysmocom less as a single point of failure there. Okay, yeah, so Osmocom needs you. We've lost too many friends already. Please don't leave Osmocom, please don't leave me. Otherwise, I'll have to cry in my bed. Okay, thanks. And I think I didn't manage to, 10 minutes earlier. So rather than taking questions now,
one feedback from Niels, okay. Just because we mentioned the NITB split again, I wanted to mention that some I found 5 points that I should have included in my talk, and I added it to the schedule there. It was just accept all RLLP OSMUX transcoding between 2G and 3G and the E1 BTS support that should have been mentioned there. Yeah. So more might be added if you take a look in the schedule.
Yeah. Okay, these are additional topics that need to be looked into. Okay, so we will wrap up here at CCC Berlin. Please make sure you take all your personal belongings and don't leave anything under the seat or above, because tomorrow we will be at EN Berlin. Linksys back there, maybe you can just quickly identify yourself in case people are not familiar with you. He will guide the group through Berlin public transport to the restaurant where we will have dinner soon. Please try to leave as soon as possible with Linksys to go there. I will go separately because I have to transport all the equipment and stuff with my car, so I will join you there as soon as possible. Okay, thanks.